Evolutionists believe that approximately 5 million years ago, humans and today's apes shared a common ancestor. Think here, a fork in the road. That creature is often referred to as an ape-like creature. They don't like to call it an ape because they're going to argue that this creature evolved into apes, and apes evolving into apes is not impressive. I'm prepared to accept that ape-like creatures produced apes. I have a little trouble with the idea that ape-like creatures became humans, and of course that's the whole realm of the ape men.
Most people are taught anthropology from a secular worldview nowadays, and when they do that, they're taught an entirely different history. People are taught, and I was taught this when I went to school as well, I was taught, hey, we evolved from some ape-like ancestor out of Africa, they migrated out of Africa to the Middle East, we got a little bit smarter, we went from hunters and gatherers to become farmers, and well, then after that, we developed some civilizations, we see Mesopotamia or Egypt or the Indus Valley, things like that. Well, then people got smarter, and we were able to start building boats and going around to different places, and all of a sudden, we see places like the Roman Empire pop up, or you know, then we transfer all the way up to England, becomes one of the most powerful nations on Earth. Then we transfer over to the Americas, and here we are. That's the kind of anthropology that we were taught. But you know what? If you go back 200 years ago and look at anthropology from that perspective, and for the 2,000 years before that, nobody believed that. That's actually a relatively new idea based on an evolutionary worldview. Anthropology, if you start with God and His Word, starts with Adam and Eve. God creates Adam and Eve.
You see, what the Bible says, what Genesis says, is that on the sixth day of the world, God made two humans, He made a whole bunch of monkeys. He never made any monkey humans, but that's what they're always looking for in the fossils. And one by one, all of the different so-called missing link fossils have been reclassified as either over to the human side or over to the monkey side. Lucy, the Australopithecus afarensis, discovered by Donald Johanson in 1973, Johanson himself said, Lucy has really been dethroned.
Meet Lucy. The nasal bones do not protrude. Do you notice any slope at all to the face? Of course. Here are the zygomatic arch to the slope, clearly ape-like. What about the forehead? Is it flat or curved? Absolutely flat. When we look from the side, the bone comes way out on this flat forehead, and it's very difficult to see whether there are orbits or eye sockets viewed from the side. Finally, cranial capacity. Lucy has a small brain by ape standards, never mind human.
Lucy had a brain one-third the size of ours, at full growth, a full-grown woman, only 65 pounds, 3.5 feet tall. This was a chimp. And the drawings and these skeletal diagrams of her standing upright, this is probably would have been very unnatural and painful, knowing now what we know about the toe bones being curved more than a modern chimp, and many other things about the fingers too. With a divergent big toe is what they're calling it now, as they've discovered more of the fossils, that means a thumb on the foot. Lucy was a chimp.
The quest for the elusive missing link fossil between ape-like creatures and humans has given rise to some of the grossest examples of evolutionary propaganda to date. Lucy, who they claim is our distant relative, is perhaps the worst. To see why, let's isolate a scanned replica of the Lucy skull, as evolutionists have imagined it, and place it next to the skull of a modern chimpanzee. What becomes immediately apparent is that the two skulls are nearly identical, with the exception that Lucy's brain cavity is even smaller. To further illustrate this, let's pass the Lucy skull into the chimpanzee skull. With the two skulls now on top of one another, it seems incredibly clear that Lucy was just a type of chimpanzee. To further illustrate the point, let's now pass the Lucy skull into that of a modern human. To be gracious, even if we scale Lucy up, she still doesn't come close to being human.
What would your conclusion be on a creature like this? I mean, clearly it's an ape. In fact, what's Lucy's scientific name? Australopithecus. That means southern ape. Whatever else we can say about Lucy, she is an ape. Let's look at another presumed ancestor of man, or a pre-Homo sapiens. It's Neanderthal man.
Problem with Neanderthals, when I was in college, they taught us they were the missing link. and they could barely grunt, you know. And now we found out that the hypoglossal canal, a hole at the base of the skull where a nerve goes out to the mouth, so controls our speaking, the hypoglossal nerve is the same size in Neanderthals as in modern people today. Monkeys have just a little thin thread-like nerve. They have the hardware, they just don't have the software drivers to actually talk. They think, they have thoughts, probably emotions, but they just can't do that like we can. Neanderthals obviously could talk.
We have every bone in Neanderthal man's body. There's not a missing bone. So we know the nasal bones protruded, just as you see them there. Even this nasal spine down here, which is just under your nose here. The nasal spine is not found on apes either. So we have the spine, we have the protruding nose. What about the slope of the face, perpendicular? What about the curvature of the forehead? It's curved enough that you can see into the orbits quite easily from the side. Finally, cranial capacity. If you compare this skull to an adult modern human skull, it's about 100 cc's or more larger. What would your conclusion be? Is this an ape or is this a human? It's obviously a human. But if it's a human, we expect more than just simply the bones. We expect some cultural evidence, and we have that.
We've found, since the time I was in college in the 70s, we found turquoise and pink colored flax fibers in Neanderthal caves. They liked colorful clothing. They were built better than us. They also had bigger brains than us. Average human today, the brain case is 1,200 cubic centimeters. Neanderthals, 1,400 cubic centimeters.
We have burial customs. We have tools of all different kinds.
They were good hunters. They had strategies. They took women on their hunting trips. One evolutionist actually said that might be why they went extinct.
Recently, they found what is arguably a cosmetics kit, a couple of scallop shells hinged with pigments in it. They have found what appeared to be flutes with holes in positions to be playable buried with Neanderthal man.
We found a musical instrument, a bare bone with holes drilled in it like a flute.
I don't know if you've ever heard a monkey play a flute, but it really doesn't work.
We find flowers buried in the graves of their dead animals. Monkeys don't bury their dead, humans do that. They had art, religion, culture, language.
Unquestionably human. And yet, when I first bought this model here of Neanderthal man, it was called Homo sapiens subspecies Neanderthalensis. In other words, they gave it a different subspecies name.
Today, the scientific designation, the classification for Neanderthal man is Homo sapiens Neanderthalensis. And that third word is actually the designation of the variety of humans that it is. We're now classified as Homo sapiens sapiens. So what creation has been saying all along is true. Neanderthals were people too.
100% human. And that's true, by the way, of the whole body, not just the skull.
The same experiment can be done with Neanderthals, which evolutionists claim is another branch in the transition from apes to humans. Let's place the skull of a Neanderthal next to the skull of a modern human. The Neanderthal has the same facial structures. We all know that everyone has a uniquely shaped skull. Some people have larger heads. Some have wider cheekbones, broader jaws and brow ridges, more slope to their foreheads. With the right combination of these traits that we see in people today, it is easy to see how a Neanderthal is simply a human.
Everyone's been told that there are dozens and dozens of these solid, missing link fossils, transitional forms. Oh, so-and-so man and Java man and Piltdown man and
Cro-Magnon man, Neanderthal man, essentially all of Homo erectus would be just human beings.
Don't just believe urban myths of the proofs of evolution like junk DNA, like missing link fossils.
The secular world teaches that you evolved from some ape-like ancestor, that there was no Adam and Eve. Oh, and since there's no Adam and Eve, well, then there was no fall into sin, which means there's no need for a savior. So see, the secular anthropology not only does it attack the authority of the Bible, it attacks the very gospel itself.
Genesis, Paradise Lost.